CLS New York, number one. Were you here?
This is Tex Malone from WBLS 107.5 in New York. We're bringing you a very special show tonight. Coming up, we've got the Spinners and Sister Sledge. Then, a little later, we will be joined live on the air by Hollywood legend and icon, Mr. Orson Welles, who will be discussing his brand new memoir entitled Mass Hysteria. Can you dig it? I know I can. So keep it tuned right here to 107.5, where we are keeping the funk alive with Life on Mars.
Small personal object from your pocket, a key, a box of matches, a coin.
Key it is. Good, sir. Hold it up 10 feet over your head and watch out for the slightest hint of hanky-panky. And behold, before our very eyes, a transformation. We've changed your key into a coin. What happened to the key? It's been returned to you. Look closely, sir. You'll find the key back in your pocket. May we see it, please?
After your old tricks, I see.
Why not? I'm a charlatan. What's that, sir? Did I used to be a magician, sir? I'm still working on it. As for the key, it was not symbolic of anything. This isn't that kind of movie.
Good evening. Welcome to In the Dark with Todd Harris Jr. I am your host, your ghost host. In part two of our exploration into the life of actor and director Orson Welles, I have now moved forward in time from the legendary, infamous War of the Worlds broadcast and its subsequent aftermath, which incited mass hysteria in 1938, to some time around 1975, when Welles had released his final feature film, titled F is for Fake. During our show tonight, which is set up as a fictitious radio interview out of New York, I will be presenting several different versions of the persona as well as the myth known for his unique approach to making art, which is sometimes referred to as Wellesian in some creative circles. I will also have a special guest calling me all the way from Indiana to discuss some of the details from the previous episode So sit back, relax, turn your lights down low as we explore the realms of the unknown. There's always an element of fear whenever the dark is near, but I promise to lead you back into the light as soon as we are finished. Now, let's begin tonight's episode, shall we? In 1975, Welles released what would be his final film, originally titled Hoax. The film is a kind of mockumentary on trickery and feints. As Welles described the film to famous film critic Jonathan Rosenbaum, who was invited to speak with Welles while living in Paris at the time, Welles described the film to Rosenbaum as something to do with the art forgerer Elmire de Horry and a recent scandal involving the biographer Clifford Irving and Howard Hughes. Was it a documentary? No, Welles explained, it was a new kind of film. Though in typical Welles fashion, he did not elaborate any further. In an essay on the film, written by Rosenbaum, he goes on to explain that Welles purposely avoided any shots in the film that might be regarded as typically Wellesian. During the opening scene, which I played at the very beginning of this episode, Welles stated that he chose to emphasize as being his own kind of magician by calling himself a charlatan, which isn't the same thing. Welles said that even then, he was faking, that everything he was doing with the documentary film was in fact a lie. This statement is important about Welles' approach to his movie making, as well as his War of the Worlds broadcast many decades before. Certainly, because in some way, it informed how one could easily see him as being able to trick his own audience into actually believing some perception of reality, based on his own commitment to craft, and by taking total control of the moment, where he therefore is able to grab an audience in that moment of conception.
One nod from an expert and that piece of canvas would be worth maybe a couple of $100,000. And now, with your permission, a bit of verse by Kipling. When first the flush of a newborn sun fell on the green and gold, our father Adam sat under the tree and scratched with a stick in the mold. And the first rude sketch that the world had seen was joy to his mighty heart, till the devil whispered behind the leaves, "It's pretty, but is it art?"
"It's pretty, but is it art? Well, how is it valued?"
"The value depends on opinion. Opinion depends on the experts. A faker like Elmire makes fools of the experts, so who's the expert?"
By that very quote from Kipling, spoken in Welles' own voice, he's essentially asking his audience, who gets to decide? What defines a human creation as art? There can certainly be no right or wrong way, according to the verse, as presented so eloquently here by Welles himself. He should know, having been a trailblazer for so many other artists who followed in his own creative footsteps. When I come back, I'll be joined by an old friend to discuss some of Welles's radio broadcast of War of the Worlds, and then we will move forward even more in depth into tonight's discussion. Stay tuned with more of In the Dark right after this. Howdy, folks. This is Tex Malone with WBLS 107.5 in New York. Hope you're having a fine, fine day. We are having such a great time here in the studio talking about Orson Welles and his new memoir, Mass Hysteria. You're going to want to keep it tuned right here, but let's smooth things out right now with some spinners.
Was an art dealer, and I, well, I was an artist. I thought I was anyway. Like Elmire, I too was once a hungry painter, but not here in France. No, I was hungry in Ireland. I'd come there to paint, bought a donkey and cart, filled the cart with paints and canvases, and went traveling. At night, I slept under the cart. It was a very nice summer. But then when I got to Dublin, the donkey had to go up for auction, and so did I. My paintings were gone, all given away to the Irish farmers who'd given me food. I'd run out of paint and money. I was 16 years old, and my career, as you might say, was at the crossroads. Winter was coming in. Oh, I guess I could have found myself an honest job as a dishwasher or something, but no, I took the easy way. I went on the stage. I'd never been on the stage, but I told them in Dublin I was a famous star from New York and somehow got them to believe me. That's how I started. Began at the top and have been working my way down ever since. If acting is an art, cooking up that bogus Broadway career was a fine case of art forgery. And then later on the radio, well, we've seen how Elmire started. In my past, there aren't any Picassos. No, my next flight into fakery was by flying saucer.
We interrupt this program to bring you a news bulletin. High government sources have ceased to deny the presence in many parts of the country of non-terrestrial objects. We return you now to the starlight terrace of the Hotel Gloria in Scranton to the singing strings of Laszlo Gabor and his melodeon.
On the radio, I got my first job from Paul Stewart, and we were lucky enough to have him join us later in the Mercury. Paul was a real capo mafia in the Martian caper.
The War of the Worlds was before World War II, remember? Before television. In the great days of radio. Maybe that's what made it all possible.
Another bulletin, ladies and gentlemen. The latest word on the monsters from outer space.
Correction, from Mars. Sorry, folks, that's what experts are saying. They are Martians.
TV would have shown us up. Half the population got the screaming jeebies just because they couldn't see how silly it all would have looked.
Well, we said that the Martians were releasing a noxious gas across the Jersey Meadows that was drifting towards New York, so people took to the hills.
I met a welfare worker years later who told me he spent weeks trying to woo some of the refugees back to civilization.
The entire state of New Jersey has now been cordoned off. State highways and... Yes?
Ladies and gentlemen, a special news flash from Washington. Any moment now, President Roosevelt will be receiving a delegation from Mars.
From Mars. Peace talks are expected.
A woman, you just have to believe this, rushed into a police station out in San Francisco with her clothes in tatters to report that she'd been repeatedly attacked by Martians. She tried to take poison for the shame of it, and they stopped her just in time. Were they little green men or what? I can't describe it, she said. It's hell.
Somebody down in South America did an imitation of that broadcast, and he ended up in prison. So I shouldn't complain, I guess. I didn't go to jail. I went to Hollywood.
Welcome back to In the Dark with Todd Harris Jr. Now, joining me live, all the way from Indiana, is my good friend John. John, how are you tonight?
I'm doing well, Todd. How are you?
I'm doing great. I know that last time we spoke, it was about zombies. Now you're back talking with us tonight about Orson Welles and his infamous 1938 broadcast of War of the Worlds. Can you tell me a little bit about your background and experience with how you first heard of the 1938 broadcast of War of the Worlds?
Yeah, so it was a mix of school, heard about it in school, heard about it through my grandparents, my parents, just, you know, hearing little bits here and there, and then, of course, I'm aging myself, looking it up through Encarta Encyclopedia on the computer.
Wow, that was a long time ago.
Yeah.
We're now in the age of Wikipedia. What are your thoughts on that one?
No comment.
Anyway, I wanted to also ask you the reason why I say your experience and a little bit of the background is because I feel like so many people learn about this particular subject through someone else, because no one was really around when it actually broadcast, or at least no one is around anymore. So a lot of it is word of mouth, and it was passed down from, you know, a generation to a younger generation. So there's been a lot of mythology built up around the actual event that occurred. So you want to tell me a little bit about that?
Yeah, so, you know, they are doing the broadcast. This is from my own research. They're doing the broadcast, and in the middle of the broadcast, someone, I'm guessing the show director, had taken a call from inside the office. Hmm. And came back with a freaked out look on his face.
Hmm.
It was from his boss telling him to stop the broadcast. People are panicking.
So you're talking about CBS, the studios?
Yes, CBS. So from what I read, they didn't stop the broadcast. Only because they were 2 minutes away from a commercial break.
I see.
So during that time, CBS, along with local news stations from around the country, were jammed with callers. Switchboards were jammed with callers asking what the hell's going on. And people assured them, you know, there's nothing, you know, we're not under attack, I promise.
So in other words, I guess where I'm going with this is that people hear about this broadcast of War of the Worlds, or have heard about it through someone who heard it from someone else. And as the story gets passed from one person to another, and then down through the generations, a lot of the myth behind what actually occurred changes over time.
I want to say it was in the New Jersey area where most of the panic was felt because of the fact that the story actually took place in a small town in New Jersey.
Even after the broadcast, producers were enamored with phone calls. One instance where this mayor of some town on the West Coast had called saying, "What the hell's going on?"
I see.
And during the broadcast, policemen showed up. Policemen, you know, news people showed up, you know, to gather more information about what was going on.
We're going to go to a break, John, and then come back. And as soon as we come back, we're going to talk a little bit about the effect that the broadcast has had on pop culture and really on pretty much everything that came after it.
Okay.
So we're going to go to a break, and right when we come back, we're going to discuss more of War of the Worlds from 1938. Plus, we're also going to talk a little bit more about the film F for Fake, which was Orson Welles' final film from 1975. More of In the Dark right after this.
It's a god-awful small affair to the girl with the mousy hair, but her mommy is yelling no, and her daddy has told her to go, but her friend is nowhere to be seen. Now she walks through her sunken dream to the seat with the clearest view, and she's hooked to the silver screen. But the film is a sad thing for she's lived it 10 times or more. She could spit in the eyes of fools as they ask her to focus on sailors fighting in the dance hall. Is there life on Mars? It's on America's tortured brow. Mickey Mouse has grown up a cow. Now the workers have struck for fame, 'cause Lennon's on sale again. See the mice in their million hordes, from Ibiza to the Norfolk Broads.
Welcome back to In the Dark with Todd Harris Jr. Joining me once again on the phone is my good friend John. John, you still with us?
Yes, sir.
Now, we were talking about the War of the Worlds broadcast from 1938, in which Orson Welles and his team of actors from the Mercury Theater created a show on the air. When they were doing the show, there was a lot of speculation afterwards that the broadcast had caused mass panic in the streets of America. And there were some other reports of suicides. You want to tell us a little bit about that, John?
Yeah, so from what I read, CBS had called the program director right in the middle of the broadcast, saying, stop the broadcast. People are panicking in the street, you know. The guy comes back with panic looked on his face, but he didn't stop the show only because they were 2 minutes away from a commercial break. Next thing you know, there's policemen, there are newspaper people, like swarming the studio, trying to gather an idea of what the hell's going on. The marquee in Times Square reads, "Orson Welles causes panic." So the broadcast ends. You know, you have like a mayor of a small town on the West Coast calling the station, asking what in the hell is going on. People in my town are panicking. I want answers.
Right. Well, we can only assume. We really are just speculating at this point what actually went down. That might have happened, what you were saying, but it might not have happened either. So, also because there was so much about Orson Welles' career that was a contradiction. He was a contradiction all throughout his entire career. One of the biggest things, too, is that in this film clip that I played before you came on in the last segment, Welles is in there talking about the advent of radio, that he was there right at the beginning with his actors from the Mercury Theater. And it was pre-World War II when they did this War of the Worlds broadcast. So it made a huge difference in how people viewed it at the time. Can you tell me a little bit about that?
Yeah, so, you know, you've got the uncertainty that people are facing. Are we going to get attacked by Hitler, you know, because of the rise of fascism in Europe?
Exactly.
You've also got the stress and anxiety built up during the Great Depression, of course.
Right.
This is right near the tail end of the Great Depression, because this is 3 years before the Japanese attacked Pearl. So,
Pearl Harbor.
All these things, people want to know just what in the hell is going on.
Well, I believe that the reason why a lot of people didn't understand was because there was no TV. Radio was the dominant format at the time. So it was a little bit odd of how they set it up. They actually used real news bulletins to make it sound like there was an actual Martian invasion happening. And that hadn't been done before. So I think that they were ahead of their time, but I don't think that they fully understood what the effect that it would have on the audience.
Well, from what I read, there was a disclaimer from the broadcast saying, "This is a work of fiction, this is fake. There's no need to panic." Well, people had missed that disclaimer because they were listening to another program on another channel. That program went to a commercial break or a music break. Then they switched the channel to War of the Worlds broadcast right in the middle of the invasion. And that's when local news stations, along with CBS, people were calling, jamming the switchboards just to gather insight into what the hell is happening.
And so that leads us into the documentary film later in Welles' life. According to an article that was written by Jonathan Rosenbaum, who's a film critic, and examined the film F for Fake, the key to Welles' fakery here, as throughout his work, is his audience's imagination and the active collaboration it performs, most often unknowingly with his own designs, the kind of unconscious or semi-conscious complicity that magicians and actors both rely on. There's a quote in there where he's basically saying, a magician is just an actor playing the part of a magician. What are your thoughts on that, John?
I mean, this is obviously Orson Welles we're talking about, you know, because he put on a show that caused conflict. Now all of a sudden he's a cult of personality.
That's a good way of putting it. One of the things in the film was he kept showing himself seated at a table where there were beautiful women there, and he was discussing his documentary. And they kept bringing food to the table, like lobster and all this fancy food. And then he at one point was like, take that away and bring me my steak. I think he was trying to also paint a picture of a caricature that they had created, that Hollywood and the media had created about him, about Orson Welles. And he was taking that and basically throwing it back in their face somehow. And I thought that was pretty brilliant. You know, so that he was basically doing his own parody in the movie, and he was kind of throwing it in there to see if people would actually pick up on it. So I thought that was pretty interesting.
Well, my take on that is this documentary serves as like a way for him to tell the public, hey, look, what happened in 38, that was the public's portrayal of me. That's how they paint me. But this is me. This is me right now. You know, Orson Welles seems to be the kind of guy who doesn't take himself seriously and is making this mockumentary to say, hey, this is not who I am. This is me. What happened years ago, they painted me in such a bad light, and what you see is right here.
That's a great way to close tonight's show, John. You hit it right on the head with that one. There were a lot of different things that Orson Welles was. He was a magician, a director, an actor, and he self-proclaimed himself to be a charlatan at one point in the film, F for fake. You've been a fantastic guest tonight on my show. I look forward to more great interviews in the future with you. And I just want to thank you for coming on tonight and discussing this very interesting and complex topic, Orson Welles.
Well, thanks, Todd. I look forward to future episodes.
You've been listening to In the Dark with Todd Harris Jr. I'm going to have Orson Welles take us out tonight instead of my usual good night.
That hour, ladies and gentlemen, is over. For the past 17 minutes, I've been lying my head off. The truth, and please forgive us for it, is that we've been forging an art story. As a charlatan, of course, my job was to try to make it real. Not that reality has anything to do with it. Reality? It's the toothbrush waiting at home for you in its glass. A bus ticket. A paycheck. And the grave. In the right mood, perhaps Elmire has just as few regrets as I have to have been a charlatan. But we're not so proud, either of us, as to lay any superior claim to being very much worse than the rest of you. No, what we professional liars hope to serve is truth. I'm afraid the pompous word for that is art. Picasso himself said it. Art, he said, is a lie. A lie that makes us
realize the truth. Oya's grandfather, floating here in the air, has no comment, which isn't surprising because he never existed.
To the memory of that great man who will never cease to exist, I offer my apologies. And wish you all, true and false, a very pleasant good evening.
En bas, une pierre, un chemin qui chemine, un reste de racine. C'est un peu solitaire, c'est un éclat de verre, c'est la vie, le soleil, c'est l'amant, le sommet, c'est un piège entrouvert, un arbre millénaire, un nœud dans le bois, c'est un chien qui aboie, c'est un oiseau dans l'air, c'est un tronc qui pourrit, c'est la neige qui fond, le mystère profond, la promesse de vie, c'est le souffle du vent au sommet des collines, c'est une vieille ruine, le vide, le néon. C'est la pie qui chacasse, c'est l'averse qui verse, des torrents d'allégresse, ce sont les eaux de Mars. C'est le pied qui avance, à pas sûr, à pas long, c'est la main qui se tend, c'est la pierre qu'on lance. C'est un trou dans la terre, un chemin qui chemine, un reste de racine, c'est un peu solitaire. C'est un oiseau dans l'air, un oiseau qui se pose, le jardin qu'on arrose, une source d'eau claire. Une écharde, un clou, c'est la fièvre qui monte. C'est un conte à bon compte, c'est un peu rien du tout. Un poisson, un geste, c'est comme du fif argent. C'est tout ce qu'on attend, c'est tout ce qui nous reste. C'est du bois, c'est un joli bout du quai. Un alcool trafiqué, le chemin le plus court. C'est les cris d'un hibou, encore ensommeillé. La voiture rouillée, c'est la boue, c'est la boue. Un pas, un pont, un crapaud qui croasse. C'est un chaland qui passe, c'est un bel horizon. C'est la saison des pluies, c'est la fonte des glaces. Ce sont les eaux de Mars, la promesse de vie. C'est Jacques, un sapin qui attaque, une entaille au talon, un pas, une pierre, un chemin qui chemine, un reste de racine, c'est un peu solitaire, un point, une bosse, une tache, un goût, un geste, une aiguille, une guêpe, un coup. L'hiver qui s'efface, fin d'une saison, c'est la neige qui fond, ce sont les eaux de Mars, la promesse de vie, le mystère profond, ce sont les eaux de Mars. Solitaire, c'est l'hiver qui s'efface, la fin d'une saison, c'est la neige qui fond, ce sont les eaux de Mars, la promesse de vie, le mystère profond, ce sont les eaux de Mars.